A lion on his side, was it his lying or his pride that brought him down? Once the king of beasts, but now they feast on the thoughts beneath his vacant crown.
The next station is Concourse B. Concourse B, as in Bravo. Hello, everyone, and welcome to Sadie Hawkins Pod.
Hello, Jessica.
Hello. Yes, it's true. We took a week off last week.
I feel like we say that we've said that every other week, Grace.
We had a really, really, really good streak for the first like year and a half of the show. Like, we were not that far behind, and I guess just after doing this for a long time, and there's been so many changes in our regular life, and I don't want to harp on all the stuff going on in our regular life, because some of my favorite YouTubers, like, once in a while, they upload a very dramatic video about, like, here's what's going on in my life, guys. I'm very busy. Like, that's all it comes down to. I'm like, it's all right. It's all right. You don't release the thing every week. It's cool. It's still following you. So whatever. I mean, there's one thing that just happened today that actually is a thing that has been very upsetting, but my grandmother passed away. Not to just leave it hanging any further, but literally the day that we're recording, that actually happened. And we took last week off just kind of coincidentally. We had a lot going on with IVF stuff and with my new job. So we're like, we need a breather. Let's take the week off. And then this happened. And so it was like, do we take another week off? And I was like, no, I don't want to forget, but I don't want to slow down. And we had this song picked. So this is just a coincidence in terms of like redoing Forget Not Slow Down, which was our 6th or 7th episode originally. It was already picked. So I don't know if it's fitting or not, because I want to talk a little bit more about my grandma in a little bit. But yeah. How's your day going, Jessica? Aside from consoling me.
I'm not
laughing at the situation. I don't know how else to handle, painful and awkward situations than to just kind of laugh a little.
I'm sitting here wondering why the table is like extra creaky tonight.
It's extra creaky because we haven't.
Like, what is going on?
Well, let's see. The table's always creaky. It's been for a couple of months.
Oh my gosh.
I think we got it. Oh, I mean, listen to that wiggle of the microphone as I wiggle the table, but listen. Oh. See, now when I'm editing the podcast, although now that I'm working, you edit the podcast again, like in the first year. But now when I'm editing the podcast, I'm always just hearing creak, 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 because we have a very creaky kitchen table we record at. But I just picked it up and I placed it back down. And it's still there, but it's not as bad as it was. Like, months and months of creaky table on the podcast. Gone away just because I went lift, drop. Well,
have to take that up with the folks at IKEA.
Right.
I love that we have like nice non-IKEA chairs, but we still have an IKEA table.
Well, it's the perfect size for the space.
It is.
So it's because we don't have a big.
It's a little two-person table.
It's not. We don't have a dining room. We have a We have a nook. We have a nook in the kitchen.
A little breakfast nook.
So it always makes sense for us to just have a two-person table and. Yeah. We used to eat dinner at the table at night like human beings.
Yes, like civilized people. And then Danny started to be like, I want to eat in front of the TV. So now we usually eat in front of the TV.
Well, you know.
When we have kids, though, family table, Dan. Got to go back to that.
Well, we will definitely have to get a bigger table by then.
Well, obviously.
And we'll get another microphone so the kids can be part of the podcast. Because the podcast mic right here. It just sits above the kitchen table all the time. Even on the occasions that we do sit at the table and eat, it's always just sitting here.
Yeah. We usually just like use the arm to extend it out of the way. Mm. So, Dan, voicemails.
Well, hold on. Do you remember that helpful Honda radio commercial where the lady used her thing to set up a podcast studio? It's like, what, do you need a laptop? So I'm pretty sure they're national commercials, but I don't know if they're in every region. But the helpful Honda people. It's like the Honda people in their Honda selling polo shirts. They go out and they do nice deeds for the community. They give out free food, or they do this or they do that, and the cameras are always there. The way they do it with the radio commercials, if you don't listen to regular radio, is a helpful Honda person calls up a real person on the phone and is like, we heard you can't you're a teacher and you can't afford your school supplies for the year because, you know, teachers are supposed to pay for their own school supplies. Well, we're buying all your school supplies. And they're like, oh my gosh, thank you. Or we heard you're in a bad way, so we're paying your tuition for the month. And it's like, oh my gosh, thank you. And they're real, because all these commercials end with blank was a real person who was paid to be on the radio. So
everyone's a real person that's paid to be on the radio that's on the radio. There aren't fake people on the radio.
Well, they mean it's not a character.
I'm telling They're you it's actors. A loophole. It's fake. I'm telling you right
yes,
now.
Yes, technically it is a real person. And as long as they use their real name, even if they're an actor playing the part of the person who was helped by the friendly Honda people, yes, they're technically still a real person. But the thing that the commercial says is these are real people. And once in a while, the helpful Honda people, you know, at the beginning of those radio, at the start of one of those radio commercials, they'd be like, this is your friendly neighborhood Honda person. And it's like, yeah, you know, I have a loved one that passed away, and the Honda person on the mic will be oh, I'm really sorry. And you actually hear like a crack in their like corporate facade for a second. Anyway, there's one where they're helping a lady get a podcast studio in her house. And it's like, oh no, what a waste. Because like the helpful Honda people will do everything.
Like, do you have a phone? Yes. Great. You can now record a podcast. Yeah.
And they're like, why? And
she's like, I've been thinking of starting a podcast.
Oh. But it's like she had just lost her job. She's like, yeah, I just lost my job, so I need a podcast studio. It's like, and they're like, she's like, and it's the most vague thing. She's like, I want to get some ideas out there.
Right.
What does that mean? Like, I know, and that's all we do. Like, on social media, we're just getting our ideas out.
Let me tell you, you make big bucks in podcasting. Right. Podcasting about vague ideas? Very lucrative.
Well, if we had gone with Anchor... Supposedly, you make money right away with that, even no matter how big your, dollars, I'm sure. No matter how big your audience is. Anyway, yeah. I wonder how that lady's doing. I wonder if she's reliable, Jay. Just kidding. No, we know it's not. What? We know. That's Josh. I'm just kidding. That doesn't even fit the reality. The joke doesn't even fit the reality of the thing. We know it's not the person. Whatever. Anyway, I guess I'll just talk about my grandma now before we get to voicemails.
Okay.
So yeah, my grandmother passed away, and she'd been unhealthy for a while. She had like she had kidney failure, and then she was having dementia. And this actually ties into Relient K in a very unexpected way, but it's really upsetting. She was like one of the closest family members I had, you know, including my mom and my dad and my sister. She's probably the next person who was kind of directly close to me family-wise. She lived with us for a long time. My grandma, she was my mom's mom. She is my mom's mom. And she lived, we had a basement apartment for her from like 1995, 94, and then she moved out around 2001. I know it had to be around 94, 95, because right shortly after she moved in, she had bought me a Sega CD. She had bought me... I remember, like, always hanging out in her apartment in our house, listening to one of the first CDs I ever bought for myself, which was Green Day's Dookie. So that's, like, you know, I know that came out in 94, but I think I got it a year later. Yeah, and she drove me to school all the time when I was going to private school and there wasn't a bus, and it was actually, like, three towns over. So, yeah, it's very upsetting. She was a very, very close person to me. And then, but one amazing thing, literally Relient K facilitated this, is that our decision to go to the Boston show, we spent that entire time, and, you know, we went to Florida in Orlando where Jessica's parents live, and we spent most of the time with them. We spent one night. They don't live in Orlando. They live like an hour and a half, 2 hours away. So we spent like one night in Orlando for that concert, and then we spent a couple of days with them outside Orlando. The Boston show, it's all very close. It's all with like within half an hour of each other. So it's like the concert, my dad's house where we were staying, and my grandma's house. They were all like right there. So every morning we would wake up and we'd go see my grandma during that trip for the yeah, Boston part. And like that might not have happened. And I don't know when the last time we saw her before that would have been. But we got to spend like 4 days. We brought her Chinese food one day. That was really nice. We couldn't really take her anywhere. Like on other trips when we've been home to Boston, we'd take her like different towns around in their downtown areas or shopping to the mall. She worked at the mall for years. She worked in Burlington, Massachusetts. We lived in Burlington, Massachusetts, and she worked at the Burlington Mall for years. She worked at the info booth. But by the end there, this year when we saw her in March, we couldn't really take her anywhere. So we brought her Chinese food and we kept visiting and saying hi and talking to her, and we wouldn't have gotten that time. And the thing is, we're like the last people other than my aunt who was taking care of her every day, who would come by every day to refill her medicine and refill her fridge. Like other than her, we're the last ones to see her at her apartment. And then like right after the trip and spending all that time with her, she started to get really sick, and they took her to the hospital, and then the hospital was like, she can't live on her own anymore. So she didn't even know, but they were having to get rid of her apartment. Like, it was really awful, but they were getting rid of her apartment while she was still alive because she could never go back there and live on her own anymore. And then she, while she was in this facility, she got COVID. She did not apparently die of COVID, but it obviously didn't help, but it was like only so much time left. So I'm sorry to, you can jump in anytime. Jessica's being very respectful of what I want to talk about. But like, anyway, you can jump in anytime.
Mama was a wonderful person.
Yes, her name was Mama. So
not her actual name. That's just what Danny called.
No, her name was Martha. Why'd you say that name? The last several years, that was always a thing. Why'd you say that name? So
yeah, she's a very special lady, and I was really close with my grandmothers, and they have both passed on when I was in high school, so it was always really nice to have Danny's grandma as well. To
yeah, did have a grandma experience.
That's right. It's much better than the girlfriend experience.
Oh my gosh, I didn't think of it that way, but that's what it sounded like.
What a somber episode. Let's get into it. Let's liven up the mood a little.
Let's not forget, but let's not slow down.
Right.
So I don't ever want to forget, but yeah, it's been a rough day. There was one other thing. Oh yeah, so it's funny. If like we didn't do this podcast, we wouldn't have seen any particular reason to fly. So, like if we weren't doing this podcast, I don't think we would have felt the compulsion of like, oh, we've got to go to the Relient K to the East Coast. Like, we would have probably, in a world where we didn't do this podcast, we would have been like, we'll wait till they come to the West Coast. Or maybe we just would have done Orlando. But we were like, I got all this time. We're doing the podcast. It'd be good to see them at least twice. Let's, you know. So we got all that time with my grandma in her apartment where she loved to be. She loved living on her own. She loved having her own space, her own apartment. So, and then we got to spend all that time with her right up to the end. Yeah. Right, not up to the end, but right before.
We were very fortunate.
We were very fortunate. So thank you, Relient K.
Yeah. Everything happens for a reason.
Yeah. Like I said, let's not forget, but let's not slow down. And we do have voicemails from going back. So let's see. We have a couple here. Right. And so, yeah, so it's been 3 weeks since we talked about a Relient K song. Because 2 weeks ago, we talked about Daydream, the Earthquake song.
That's right.
And then last week.
Oh my gosh, I was legit sitting here like 3 weeks ago. We did not talk about that Wiz Khalifa song. What are you talking about?
Right. So here's one voicemail, which I'm pretty sure we didn't play two or three weeks ago.
Hey, this is Josh, PhD Josh. So I was just listening through to your episode, and you twice brought up the quote, if you don't like the weather in X place, wait 5 minutes. And of course, nobody knows where it comes from. I've actually dug into it, and like, nobody knows where it comes from. It seems to have originally, or at least first, been stated in a newspaper about Chicago. And then later, somebody said, after Mark Twain had died, somebody said that Mark Twain actually first said it before the Chicago piece about New England, specifically New York.
Well, New York's not part of New England, unless that was a thing back then. Right?
Probably was a thing back then.
Maybe it was a thing back then. Now,
it's close enough. Whatever.
New England is the five states,
oh boy,
and New York.
Oh, boy.
New York's not part of New England. Maybe it was considered part of New England back then. Whatever. But you know how, like, New England with New York looks like a kangaroo? Did you ever, were you ever taught that when you were a kid?
I don't think so.
Maine is the head. Cape Cod on Massachusetts is the arms. Rhode Island is the, like, the feet. Rhode Island, and then New York is the tail.
Gotcha.
So we got this big old kangaroo on the top right of the United States of America. But New York's not part of it, so you can't say
New
England.
Why are you gatekeeping New England, Danny?
Before you know it, Newfoundland is going to be like, oh, we're part of New England as well.
And then in 1940, it was attributed to Will Rogers, an Oklahoma news personality about Oklahoma. So with that in mind, I would like to make the argument that it should apply to Oklahoma and or Kansas most, because being from Oklahoma, Oklahoma has no natural lakes. So whereas like Florida or any of the coastal regions have water that sort of like makes sure the temperature at least is more cool or is more not cool, even the Oklahoma and those like more interstates don't.
I know all about Oklahoma weather. We all know
this
the wind comes sweeping down the plain. We all know the lyrics to the musical where the wind comes sweeping down the plain. We get it.
You're why people don't want to leave voicemails, Danny.
Also, Oklahoma and Kansas are the very middle of the United States. I think it's 20 miles north of their border. And they're also very much plains states, at least in the middle of them. So you have those cold winds coming down from Canada and those warm winds coming up from the Gulf of Mexico and Texas and Mexico, which is why that part of the country is known as Tornado Alley. So you have all sorts of different weather all coming together. So it actually, like, when people move to Oklahoma, they're like, well, this was a thing where we're from. But it actually more applies here than anywhere else I've lived. So, yeah, that's just one possibility.
That's interesting because, yeah, everywhere where that saying, which we've brought up on the podcast multiple times, but we got this voicemail almost over 10 days ago. Because it's been so long since we had a proper episode. And then, like, at the same time, someone DM'd us about us talking about that saying as well. So something about that saying really gets people's attention.
Yeah, that's funny.
And talking about where it comes from. But I've, like, never heard it referred to as, like, a Middle America thing. I've always heard it referred to as,
that's
like...
so interesting.
It's,
well, that's because you've never lived in Middle America.
No.
Except for the few months you spent in Chicago.
Right. Well, thank you, Josh, for calling. And there are a few more. There are two more voicemails from someone who says it's their first time calling. Oh, it's Sam, because we... Sam Henson, because we talked about her cover of Daydream two weeks ago. So she called up.
Yo, this is my first time calling in. This is Sam. Actually, ironically, I am driving from Sacramento to L.A., so your podcast did distract me. But I was listening to the Daydream podcast. I'm about, like, halfway through it, and I just wanted to make some comments, positive comments. But I'm, like, totally, totally obsessed with this album. It was, like, one of the albums that kind of got me back into Relient K, besides, like, the tour. It was, like, the 10-year anniversary one. But, so... Wind Up Bird was actually mixed by Aaron King, who is the drummer of Meat Snap and then Supra and everything. So, and that's kind of like what he's been doing. And there's like a cool whole story that I've done just snooping on Instagram and Reddit and stuff like that. But I think that's how Ellie got connected, was because she's been working with one of the other people from Mute Math. I forget his name, the lead singer. But I'm curious. I bet Robert Day probably knows more. But I think that could be the connection, is that Darren maybe called her up, because it seems like they already had an existing relationship. And two other notes that I had. Okay, the familiarity of the song. It's really interesting. Relient K is getting into you is basically Daydream. So if you, or in my opinion anyway, it's like, if you speed up Getting Into You, it's like the same verse chords. So I think that's why it's familiar. And then I would also say, like, lastly, the lyrics with Daydream, it's so similar to Savannah, because it's like the longing for someone. And I think, like, Matt does that in a lot of his songs. So it'd be fascinating to know, like, who specifically he is longing for with this song. But because I think, like Flower, I know, is the you know, it's part of, like, the Forget and Not Slow Down type of song. And I know he has, like, a lot of other ones. So it's, like, it might just be, like, a fuse that he had. But that's always what I thought of when I listened to it. So, but, yeah, I hope you guys are doing well. I'm excited that you're diving deep into this, and I'll take a picture of the album cover art when I get home. When I get home, can't talk, but yeah, I'm going to continue getting distracted by your podcast. Bye!
Well, thank you. And then she called back with a follow-up that's 1 minute long. But before that, Tim Wilson gave us a scan of the inside sheet to the Wind Up Bird vinyl. So we have all the official lyrics, okay, and it is not "the temperature is dropping the hint" or whatever that stupid misheard lyric was.
Dropping the heat.
And it is the hint.
It is the hint. It is not the heat.
Whatever the bad, yeah. It was not the heat. It is hint. So we or someone has to go correct that, and then if you need to use the photo, we have the photo from Tim Wilson, which includes the credits that aren't in the CD. And the other thing is, yeah, I've already talked to Robert Gay about being on the podcast again, because spoiler warning, he was Dermike when Dermike.
What?
When Dermike was on the episode, it wasn't the real Dermike. It was Robert Gay.
I have been bamboozled.
I know. I'm so sorry.
Is this why you said I didn't need to be in the interview with you?
Yeah, because I needed to trick you. I didn't want you to be culpable. I didn't want you to know.
I mean, I guess I appreciate that. Can't I, like, choose not to testify against you anyway because we're married? Right. Isn't that a thing?
That is true. So, anyway, we're going to have Robert Gay on for some episode sometime. It just seemed like a good way to jump in with the two biggest songs on Spotify, which also happened to be, like, not the album opener, but the first single, and then the album closer, and then we can get into the rest of the meat of the album and have Robert on one of those episodes. But yeah, that's all interesting stuff, and I'm glad to find out. I didn't pay attention to who the producer were, the mixers were. The mixer was, I mean, it's probably on Discogs, but it was, like I said, we didn't have a copy of the insert. And I don't know why they didn't put anything on the CD. They didn't put credits. Yeah, they didn't put anything in the CD. And it was a new copy. It was a shrink-wrapped copy.
Yeah.
So it's not... And I think I got it directly from SMLXL. I'm pretty sure I got it directly from them. I didn't get it even from Amazon or anything. Maybe I got it from Collide Records or something like that. But it was definitely a brand new copy. My point is, not a refurbished copy. Because that does happen sometimes now with physical media. Some people take a mint CD and just rewrap it and say it's new to upcharge when it's like a sought after thing. I don't know if anyone would do that with Wind Up Bird, but technically it's plausible on Amazon. So here is Sam's follow-up call. I know that this happens because, sorry, re-shrink wrapping like mint used media or previously opened media and then selling it as new so you can upcharge it as new, I know that happens. For one reason I know it happens is because I bought a Nintendo game once that was new, and when I opened it up, the frequent buyer Nintendo points inside had already been used.
Oh, Oh, no.
But because I didn't buy it from a reputable seller, like anything from Target to, you know, Best Buy, I just bought it from some rando on Amazon who had clearly just re-shrink-wrapped a game that was in perfect condition. I couldn't do it. I wasn't going to do anything about it. I'd be able to do anything about it. So anyway, here is Sam's follow-up call.
Hey, it's Sam again. I hopefully I'm not going over time, but I just listened to the whole thing, and thanks for featuring my cover. I appreciate it. I really love that song a lot. And then I've done a couple of others too, because again, you know, like one of my albums I was really obsessed with for a while. I was also thinking too, I forgot to mention this earlier, there's a really cool story about like the album art too. I found him on Instagram, and I can send you guys his handle via Instagram, but it's like someone that Matt met at a bar in Columbus, and they like ended up drinking beers together and stuff, and then he like really loved his artwork, and he does like graffiti and stuff like that all throughout Ohio. So, and I started following the guy, so I was like, this is really sick artwork. So, but it's cool. Seems like Matt kind of salt of the earth type.
Oh. Well.
I'll see you later, probably.
Okay.
Awesome insight.
Yeah, some of the last few seconds there got cut off, but I think we got everything. Yeah, that's an interesting insight, and we'll have to find out.
Yeah, thanks for calling. And also, send more covers.
Right. But, spoiler warning, because we did talk about it 2 weeks ago when we did Daydream, and we found Sam's cover, that the only other cover she had that was like that I immediately saw that was relevant to us was Forget Not Slow Down. So we have that cover again, if I think from the same club. We'll talk about that when we get to covers. There's a little bit more to it than that. Yeah, thanks for calling. So we'll get
thank you, Josh, for your call.
And thank you. Yes. So Forget Not Slow Down. So this was our Burden to B-Sides is first, right? So the first five albums and six and seven. So this was originally our seventh episode. And it's just one that I felt the need, I felt like I wanted to redo. And I don't really think we need to redo almost any. It's really, when it comes to us redoing episodes, it's just a matter of, did we feel like we missed something? Did we feel like we weren't quite there yet? Like, Savannah was an early episode, and we've learned a little bit more about Savannah since then, but I don't think we need to go back, because we discovered so much while we were doing that episode, that I don't feel like a whole nother Savannah episode would be beneficial. But I do feel like when we originally did Forget Not Slow Down, this kind of had the most going on out of all of the first tracks that we did. And I feel like we missed, if anything, we missed a certain vibe that was important to the song. And like all our redo episodes, I deliberately have not gone back to listen to our previous episode. Like, this is a Forget Not Slow Down situation.
Same.
Like it was with Hello McFly and everything else we've redone. We just keep going forward. So if we repeat things that maybe if you already heard it in a previous episode, if you remember that episode better than we do, oh well, it'll just prove that those points were salient because we repeated them a second time. But hopefully we've learned more over the last couple years talking about other Forget Not Slow Down album tracks and seeing the relevance of this song overall, because I definitely feel like I understand this album better because of this podcast. And really, if this was our first song from this album that we talked about, we barely had our feet wet when it comes to this album.
Yeah, absolutely. I was going to say, I like love this album now. It's now like my favorite album of all time, I think, from any artist. So yeah, I definitely have more to say about like the song.
Controversial. Just kidding.
The album in general now. So I just kind of took some general album notes that I wanted to mention before we dive into the song. Just this album is so stunningly vulnerable. It's going on the journey of someone's breakup, like the bad, the messy, the therapeutic. It's an unfettered look into the stages we all go through during heartbreak. And I just think that is so incredible. And I actually, and Danny, you personally, just because we do talk about this like off mic, I came to a new understanding and appreciation of Sahara when I was listening through the other day at the gym. I like listened to the whole album through twice. And Sahara has never been my favorite song, but when I was listening to it, I realized that Sahara is actually the most honest and vulnerable song on the album. Was it the lying or the pride that brought him down? Like, it's just right there out in the open. It's just, right. You know, like, I've lied and I'm prideful, but please don't turn your back on me. You know, don't turn me loose even when I turn my back.
Right.
You know, like, it's just right there. Mm-hmm. And when we covered that song, I think I might have taken more of, like, a religious look at it, at the don't turn me loose line.
I mean, it could be both. Like, yeah. Oh, yeah, like classic Relient K songs. For sure. That's discussions that get some people mad at me. It could be about God and a girl. It could be a duality, as art and poetry is meant to do. There's not a singular interpretation. So if he's saying, please, relationship I'm in, don't turn me loose. Oh, also God, please don't turn me loose. It's the same situation.
Yeah, and as we've talked about before, like, I think that you should take what you take from songs, and Death of the Author, and, you know, what the true intention is. Doesn't matter if you can find something in it that speaks to you in the way you need it to. And that's something that I'm going to actually talk about later on the song we're recovering today. And I think that's honestly one of the greatest things about this album, is that I've listened to it front and back dozens of times now, and I'm still making new discoveries, mm-hmm. which I think is just, like, really, really cool. And the sequencing of this album is why I've said in the past that it's like a rock opera, just going through those different stages of post-breakup grief. I mean, I look at the placement of Sahara, followed by Savannah, the Savannah Suite, and then If You Believe Me. And we know that the narrator has lied. He's acknowledged it three tracks prior. And now he's like, but hey, remember the good times? If you would just believe me, believe my lies, we could stand the test of time. We could move on. And then there's that frustration and anger of realizing she's not going to come back. And that's fine, because he's made it through worse. So this is the end, if she wants it to be the end. And, you know, he lays his cards on the table, like, even in this opening track of If I Become What I Cannot Accept, Resurrect the Saint Within the Wretch. Mm-hmm. Like, it's just, you know, so good. So, like, it's all out there.
Yeah. I mean, this song is obviously a mission statement. I don't know if that's the most appropriate phrase, but it is like a thesis for the album as a whole, aside from the fact that it's the title track. And, I mean, write this down into the Questions for Teason Maybe Someday file. And maybe this is in the documentary, but I've never watched the making of documentary for this album from beginning to end. I know you have. And maybe that's a Patreon we should do soon, now that we have our whole streaming setup capable. But I would be curious where the decision was for, you know, naming this album. Because it seems pretty clear from what we know about, like, the origin of this album as a whole, that he went sort of into seclusion on his own in a cabin apart from his everyday life to specifically be secluded and write this album, and then come back and work on it with the band, and they kind of help fill out the writing of the music, you know, and complete things there. And then you watch that Mark Lee Townsend video where he talks about the 10th anniversary of Forget Not Slow Down, the album, and in that YouTube video, he opens up the Pro Tools stems for Savannah. But he talks about the creation of that album there as well, and he says, like, you know, this might be technically a down thematic album, but it was not a down experience, right? So it still was kind of like an uplifting, hopeful experience. Maybe not in every moment for Teason when he's writing these songs, but that is kind of like, that's the way his music comes across, so I would think that's the way he kind of operates, is, like, to be an optimist, even in the most pessimistic circumstances. I'm kind of sidetracking myself here, but my point I'm getting at is, like, he's writing all these songs, and he writes Forget Not Slow Down, and in that moment, is he like, oh, this is a good title for the album? Or does he just finish all the songs and then bring it back to the studio with Mark Lee Townsend and the rest of the band, and do they start discussing album sequence and the title, and then, you know, the artwork by his uncle, the painting of the trailer and everything on the cover? Does that all come in after? Like, I would be really curious to know, just from, like, how much specific planning happened in that cabin writing session. Like, did Teason this, did he have ideas of what this album as the album, as the piece of work that it is, the full album experience? Did he have ideas for that, or was that stuff that was discussed after the fact? Because the title, because making this the title track would be a part of that, and I'd be curious, because what it's like a thesis statement for the album as a whole, like keep moving forward, forgetting and not slowing down. Like it kind of encompasses, there's a wide range of emotions in every song on this album, but that sentiment kind of says it all, forget and not slow down. It's the name of the album, obviously. And then this kicks off the title track experience with Relient K, because up to now, there's never been a title track, right? And I don't know if that's significant, if that was planned or discussed. I think it was Tim called up and mentioned that. Someone called up recently and mentioned, like, the last three albums have all had title tracks, and there's never been a title track before, except technically, where the pre-gap track is called but that wasn't even like confirmed until the 10th anniversary version. So speaking of the pre-gap track, we did our cover of it, but just to mention that again, I know we mentioned it both in the Sahara episode and in the original Forget Not Slow Down episode, but the pre-gap track on the CD, if you have the right kind of CD player, you put it in. And we talked about pre-gap tracks on this podcast so much, and I know that, like, in those first few episodes, we didn't even know it was called pre-gap at the time. We thought it was just called zero track. We're like, what is this? What is this thing? Where if you have the right kind of CD player, you put it in your CD player, and you immediately push the rewind button, and you find the negative seconds before the first track. And it's like a hidden track that only certain types of CD players that have that capability to rewind before the first track will allow you to hear it. So the pre-gap track to this album is Matt Thiessen's father singing the bassy version of lyrics from Sahara. And then some versions of the album have the Concourse B audio and some do not. But I have to think that that's significant as well, to like, here's the title track. The opening song to the album is also the title track. It says everything you're gonna feel and learn in this album. You're looking at my hair. Do I need to comb my hair?
Yeah. Something about Danny is that he never brushes his hair, and so I'm the one who cuts it. So usually, and I didn't do it this time, I cut it in a way so that it is pre-styled for him. And I did not do that this time. Eyeing up his hair like, oh, I need to do a little work on the top.
I didn't take the hairbrush song by the VeggieTales seriously enough. So it feels significant to like the most important songs, the most like forward, like here's the beginning of the album. It's a piece of Sahara, which you just talked about before. And then Forget Not Slow Down. Like, those are the opening moments of the album. Like, to take this piece of Sahara and then go right into the title track, like, there seems to be something important there. To say that this, maybe these are very important lines from Sahara, and it sets up the emotion that you're going to feel, like an overture. And then here's the title track that's going to encompass everything else. A range of everything that I'm going to be singing about for the rest of the album. I mean, me and the talking about Thiessen and the.
Or Thiessen's like, hey, my dad sung this bit and I think it's kind of funny. Let's just put it at the beginning.
It could have been that simple.
I don't know. I think that it's funny that the first song of this album, as well as Collapsible Lung, kind of lull you into a false sense of security. You're like, yeah, we're going to get the usual rock/pop punk Relient K we're used to. And like, this is such a peppy kickoff for such a deep and emotional roller coaster of an album.
It is.
Yeah.
One other thing I was realizing on this listen is that the mixing on at least this song, and now I have to go and really pay attention to the rest of the album. Well, this definitely wouldn't be the case for Sahara. Forget Not Slow Down, like the title track, the mixing, it's like every instrument has equal play, has equal chance. Like they're all on like a socialist level mixing wise.
Like they're editing Bohemian Rhapsody.
I guess.
Everybody gets equal camera time.
Oh, the movie, right.
Yeah. I thought, like, sorry.
No, you said editing, But in my mind, I thought you said mixing, like, the song Bohemian Rhapsody. No, yeah, the editing of the movie Bohemian Rhapsody, like, it's a horribly edited movie, but the fact that they won
It's a very technically proficiently edited movie.
Well, that's the thing, is it's, like, it's artistically horribly edited, and there's a number of YouTube videos that'll show why it's some of the worst editing ever, but if you actually know what those editors had to go through, you realize, technically speaking, they deserve an Oscar, because, like, everyone had to have, like, equal airtime, so they're having to do, like, mathematical equations for the editing while they're working on horrible coverage, like, between one problematic director and another director that came on to pick things up. It's like they barely had coverage for different scenes, and they managed to put something together that also followed this mathematical equation that swaged everyone's egos of the surviving members of Queen. Anyway, I don't remember the thing I was saying. Oh, so the mixing of this song and maybe some of the rest of the album is like, there's no single melodic instrument that really feels like it has the full lead on this track. Between the piano, the guitars, and the bass, like, everything is very evenly mixed, but not like back. Like, everything is just kind of matched. Like a lot of other Relient K songs, like, the guitar is forward, and in a lot of, like, punk songs, like, the bass is forward. And, you know, for being a piano-driven band, like, after some other Relient K songs, the piano is kind of driven forward. But everything is very much mixed on an even level here. There is that dropout right as the lyrics start, where it cuts down to just an acoustic guitar. But other than that, when all the instruments are kicked in, nothing's really leading the melody. It's all just this, like, perfect symphony harmony between all the guitars and the piano. And then the main thing we learned when we talked to Ethan Luck on this show was how I always had this melodic sense of the drums, and I guess the drums feel forward because they have this very specific sound on this album that they don't have on any other album. They have a very warm, room-like sound, which makes sense for the album as a whole. But then Ethan Luck explained to us how he did a Phil Collins thing deliberately, where some of his drum parts would deliberately match the cadence of the lyrics. So I don't know if I didn't actually pay attention if that happens in this album, but just knowing that there is that, like, very, I'd rather forget, and it's, so if he's hitting the, remember he said that? I'm not alone in remembering this, right? So even if that wasn't specifically happening on this song, I'm sure there was, like, an inkling of that happening. I feel like, it's just, what a great song that it's all kind of like equal footing for all the mixing, with the exception, like I said, of that drop down. One other thing that I keep thinking is, like, on the live album and then in and everything else, I think they've always, when they, I don't know if it counts as the bridge, but when things kind of drop down in towards the end of the song, this part. Rather forget and not slow down. So live, Thiessen never starts singing this build-up section right away. They do a whole build-up section and then stop, and then Thiessen cuts into these lyrics. Remember that? On the live album, they do this every time. So they do it on the live album, but when I went back and listened to some live performances from the time the album came out, they've always been doing that live. So I really want to know if this, like they do the stop, and then they do the slow build up, and on the album, Thiessen immediately starts singing. Every time they've ever done it live, they do one whole repetition of the build up, stop, and then do the build up again with the lyrics. What came first? Because it seems like they've never done it the album way, as far as I can find from any live version I've checked out on YouTube, and the live album itself, and both times we went to And then every other time we saw footage on YouTube or on Instagram when it was happening. When I hear the studio version, I don't want Thiessen's lyrics to kick in immediately on that rebuild up. I actually, now it kind of has ruined the studio version for me a little bit. And in that way, I kind of prefer the live album version. But Whatever.
It's funny. So this song has become a mantra for me personally, and I'm sure it's become a mantra for a lot of you out there. Recently, there have been things in life that have affected me that I couldn't control, and I have control issues. I feel very helpless in situations when they arise that I have no control over, and I have difficulty processing those situations. It's something I've been working on with a therapist. So when things arise and are out of my control, I just keep telling myself that I'd rather forget and not slow down. I can't change this, but I can change how I let it affect me. I can let it happen, pour over me, and then wash my hands of it. And when I labor over these things, because I will fixate on situations that I cannot control, and I just keep telling myself it's time to befriend the ghosts of all the things that haunt me most, so they leave me alone. So I know that this song is about regret, and I take this song about regret and I apply it to a different circumstance, and it still rings true, and it helps me move on, even if just temporarily.
That totally makes sense. I was actually getting a little sad today listening to this song again before the podcast and thinking about my grandmother. Because, yeah, I mean, even though this is a song, even though this is an album about regret of a specific situation, that's not relevant to the way it was written. Like, it's kind of meant to be felt in a number of ways. And this makes me think of two things for the overarching theme of Relient K appreciation. The first is when I think about, we did that Patreon episode where we purposely went and looked for negative reviews from the time. Fan reviews, not right. Negative. I mean, I'm sure we could find a negative review by an actual blog or music reviewer.
But oh, man, I did not bookmark it because I felt like we had probably already done it. But Punk News gave us like 2.5 stars. And I'm like, what?
We know it wasn't Greg. We know it wasn't Greg Simpson because we talked to him about him a bit about that on our They Might Be Giants episode. Like, he never wrote a Relient K review, so it's fine for us to badmouth that Punk News reviewer. Yeah, so we, on a Patreon episode, we went on iTunes before someday Apple decides to scrub all of iTunes and force you to only use Apple Music. We went and we read every 1- and 2-star review from like the year that Forget Not Slow Down first came out. And what a lot of people were saying when they had that review is like, why is every song got to be about a girl? And it's so freaking offensive because it's like, he's not talking about chicks like some sort of party punk band. You know, he's not talking about babes. He's not talking about trying to hook up. He's talking about one of the loves of his life and these like regrets that he's had. And when you're like talking about, I don't know, Hawk Nelson or MXPX and they sing about a girl or something, or you're listening to the radio to some secular punk band and they're singing about sex or babes and you're like offended, like that's one thing. But when you're singing, when you're listening to somebody bearing their soul about regret of a personal relationship, like, that's so wrong-headed. Like, could you imagine if, like, you go to church and you ask for prayer because you've had your heart broken, and then the person looks at you and just, you want your prayer to be about chicks? Like, these people, I hope these people grew up from that, from those reviews, because it's really offensive when you think of, like, the real meaning behind this album.
I don't know. I used to pray for a boyfriend. I asked Santa for a boyfriend 1 year. Again, I believed in Santa for far longer than I should have. Oops. Santa, spoiler warning.
Uh-oh.
Mark that off on Does the Dog Die.
Yeah, does Santa spoil. And but then the other thing that reminds me of is, like, and this became a negative review for our podcast on Apple Podcasts, the fact that I'm, like, constantly looking at songs and trying to see like the non-religious meaning behind them. And I'm sorry, but like in like with Be My Escape, like I think it is deliberately written to be about anything. And even if it is written from the point of view of Thiessen's relationship with Christ, Be My Escape, I think he deliberately went through that song and wrote it in such a way that it was vague enough that you can, when you sing Be My Escape in your head, it can be about anything you want. I'm sure there could have been a first draft of Be My Escape where there's specific language to him talking about Christ, but I don't think that language exists in the song as we know it. So it's a similar thing here where, like, Forget Not Slow Down is written about his relationship with his fiance. You could listen to these songs, and only a couple of the songs on the album overall definitely have specific language of this is about a woman I love, like Candlelight or something, and maybe some other songs. But even though the intention is clear, if you went through with a fine-tooth comb on a lot of these songs, you could make it about you lost your grandmother, or you lost an opportunity for a job, or you lost some other loved one, or you feel like you've fallen away from God. Like, you can make it about, or we have, someone wrote to us one time and said, Forget and Not Slow Down became a very important album to them when they lost a really, not lost in the death sense, but lost, like, the relationship with a friend. Like, a friend that they'd had forever, and they lost that relationship. They drifted apart as friends, or they broke off their friendship. And this became the anthem to them for that. Teason is not writing this song about the loss of a friend in that sense. Like, yeah, it's his fiance, so it's a friend in one sense. But he's not writing about a platonic friend. But you can make listening to the song about a platonic friend, just like you can. So I guess in that way, I'm just saying, like, with all the other times I harp on, like, this song can be about God or a girl, even if everyone thinks it's about God. This is the opposite of that. This is an album that is definitely about a relationship with another human being, with a girl. And you can make this these songs about your relationship with Christ, your relationship with God. So it's a two-way street, despite the fact that some people are upset with me that I'm always harping on this same theme overall with Relient K music.
Yeah, so like you said, this, like we said, this song is clearly about like moving on and moving past regret, and that is a common Relient K theme. Mm-hmm. But of all the different songs about like regrets and moving on from them, this is the one that, like, when I'm trying to move past my own regrets in my own life, that I'll put on repeat, like, and just say to myself over and over again, I'd rather forget and not slow down. Like, it's just so good. And the number of one-liners you can take away from this song, I mean...
a lot of tattooable lines.
Yeah. 100%. Like, you know, just forget and don't slow down instead of gathering regret for the things you can't change now. Like, it's so true.
Someone else once said, moss grows on a rolling stone. Moss does not grow on a rolling stone. Whatever.
You almost have to wish that this was also the last track, because it's a perfect opener. But it would leave the narrator in a much better place mentally if you ended here, because the album actually ends on a bitter note with nothing resolved. And sometimes that's unfortunately what happens in a fractured relationship. You don't get closure. But this song still has that positive, hopeful note that we always attribute to Relient K songs.
Mm-hmm. So let's like read through the lyrics just a little, which I don't know if we did last time. How many times can I push it aside? Is it time I befriend all the ghosts of all the things that haunt me most? So they leave me alone, move on with my life. Be certain the steps of left and right don't fight the direction of upright. That's definitely a lyric I've just taken for granted. I've never like fully comprehended what he said there. I just like, oh, that sounds good.
Yeah.
I don't need to dive into that lyric. So let me take a second there. Be certain the steps of left and right don't fight the direction of upright. Totally got it. The steps of left and right, meaning stepping forward, moving forward, forward motion, that as he's walking forward, making sure that as he's moving forward, it doesn't fight the fact that he's standing upright. Like, he wants to keep moving forward, but he also needs to actually be standing upright to be moving forward. So it's like, you know, like, you think you're ready to get on your feet? Maybe you just had your blood drawn and you're woozy, and the nurse is like, oh, don't get up yet. And you're like, no, I'm ready to put my left foot and my right foot down. And they're like, oh, no, you'll be fighting upright. That happens to me every time. Every time I have my blood drawn, I get very woozy. And I'm always ready to go, and the nurse never believes me. They're like, because to them, if I fall, that's on them. That's a lawsuit right there or whatever. But I don't want to sue anybody. I'm just like, no, I'm just ready to go. I got to get out of here. I got to flop sweat. I got to go home and change my clothes. I'd rather forget and not slow down than gather regret for the things I can't change now. If I become what I can't accept, resurrect the saint from within the wretch, pour over me and wash my hands of it. And like, that's also sort of a religious sounding line, pour over me and wash my hands of it. Especially with the resurrect the saint from within the wretch. Like, it has sort of baptismal inklings, even though it might not absolutely read as that, depending on how you take it. But I can see that in that line. It's time to decide which is out of my mind. I always thought it was she's out of my mind. Is genius?
It's which?
It's which? Okay, maybe it's just one of those lyrics I've always just kind of like not properly sussed out listening to it and just assumed. I was like, it's time to decide. She's out of my mind. Like, I thought she's out of my mind. I always thought he was saying,
maybe
like,
I thought it was when she's out of my mind.
Okay, well,
maybe
genius,
I think that's
says
what I usually say. We
could go get the book, but genius says which is out of my mind. And I always thought it's she's out of my mind, which I thought was a playful phrasing of like, you're feeling out of your mind, but she's out of my mind, which, you know, at this point has to be like delusion because she's not out of his mind. She's living rent free up there.
Out of sight, out of her mind.
Oh, yeah. It's an 80s movie, very under the radar. I think it's VHS only, called She. It's Out of Sight, Out of Mind. But it's also called Out of Sight, Out of Her Mind. Like, literally, like, everywhere you look at the movie on IMDb, or on the screen itself, or on the VHS tape itself, or on the case, it's always, it may or may not say she's out of her mind. Out of sight, out of mind. Or is it out of sight, out of her mind? I don't know. And it's about a woman whose kid gets kidnapped or killed. I don't remember. And then
I thought it was called 13th Floor.
No, we watched it in a triple feature of 13th Floor movies. And maybe there was a working...
Because it has an alternate title.
It might have had an alternate title.
Yeah.
One time we watched three different movies that all were around the idea of a 13th Floor. We watched The 13th Floor from the 90s. We watched a different 13th Floor, that Australian movie, which made no sense. There was like an electric demon in the building, but it was really not understood or explained properly. And the girl's dad was like a gangster, and they went hiding in some... Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
The girl's dad was like a gangster, so they hide out in an old office building. But I'm like, but they're hanging out partying?
Yeah.
And then later you find out, oh, they're hiding from
her gangster
dad. And
it was also maybe kind of haunted, and it was
by an electricity demon. An electricity demon does help them or doesn't help them and kill some people but doesn't kill other people. None of it is explained properly.
Yeah.
And then we watched Out of Her Mind, Out of Sight, which was filmed right here, and we recognized all the buildings.
Yeah.
Now I've lost interest in reading the rest of the lyrics. Because I could spend my life just trying to sift through what I could have done better, but what good do what-ifs do? Uh-oh. So this line is really fun because it's such a tongue twister,
mm-hmm.
but it feels so natural. It's one of those things like good special effects. You don't notice them when they happen, but it's
right.
Like, it's such so windy, and it feels like anyone can learn this tongue twister. It's like a fun roller coaster lyric that's actually very deep and meaningful. It's like you want to go through and think about all the things you messed up on and all the decisions you should have made. But what good does that do you to sit around and think about how you should have done stuff? But to do it in such a, to put that very deep sentiment in such a fun roller coaster lyric is interesting. The chorus again, and then the bridge. Because I could spend my, oh, it's the same thing. I could spend my life trying to sift through what I could have done better, but what good do what ifs do? Uh-oh. There's something I should tell you. There's something I should tell you now. Which maybe, you know, kind of ties things together because he's constantly trying to tell this lady stuff, like, especially in If You Believe Me Now. What?
Stop mansplaining, Jason.
So then, well, we'll let April get the barks out.
And we're going to go to break. We'll be right back.
We just want to take a moment to thank you for listening to Sadie Hawkins Pod. Whether you've been listening for a while or this is your first time, we want to hear your thoughts on this episode, your corrections, and your Relient K memories at our voicemail line, which is 402-95-SADIE.
And if talking on the phone isn't your thing, because I know it's not mine, and whose is it really, you can send us an email to sadiehawkinspod@gmail.com or visit our socials at Instagram and Twitter, which are both @SadieHawkinsPod. While there, you can also see the visuals we discuss on the podcast each week.
You can also visit sadiehawkinspod.com for easy access to all these links as well as to our merch store for shirts, mugs, stickers, and more.
We also want to thank our patrons at patreon.com/SadieHawkinsPod, who include
Charity, Isaac, James, Kindle, Joshua, Timothy, Daniel, Jay, Eric, Joel, Connor, Michael, Samantha, Jimmy Eat Pod, This Might Be a Podcast, Tucker, and Brady.
Join our Patreon now for 2 monthly bonus episodes, our entire backlog of bonus episodes, which include reviews of the K's for Karaoke songs and chapters of the complex infrastructure known as the Female Mind Book. You'll also get stickers, guitar picks, and a special Patreon exclusive shirt when you've donated a lifetime contribution of $60.
Ooh, that sounds like fun. Where can I sign up again?
At patreon.com/SadieHawkinsPod. If you want to be a patron of the arts, the fine arts, the podcast arts, there's one place to go.
SadieHawkinsPod.com/. Oh, wait. No, that's not it. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I panicked.
Very early on in the podcast, I apparently just kept my deep dive tabs open on my phone and didn't write them down in my notes. So I'm not sure what we've gone over and what
that's
we
okay.
Haven't.
Forget it. Don't slow down.
There is the Wikipedia is there. And so while it doesn't necessarily answer your question from before, it sort of maybe addresses a little bit of that. So in early 2009, Relient K's vocalist Matt Thiessen, secluded from the rest of the world in Winchester, Tennessee, began to write music for 3 months on an album to be released later in 2009. About being isolated, Thiessen stated, "It was awesome. You could think about something and keep thinking about it, and no one would interrupt you for 6 or 7 hours. You could keep your brain on the train of thought. I'll never want to write another record another way." Well,
that wasn't true. No, instead he surrounded himself by everybody for the next record.
Thiessen stated that they were keen on finishing the album for a 2009 release and had begun recording the new album with their favorite producer, Mark Lee Townsend, and mixer, Andy Wallace. Guitarist Matt Hoops stated about Mark Lee Townsend that, "We've got an almost telepathic relationship." On March 23rd, 2009, the band started recording at Dark Horse Recording Studio in Franklin, Tennessee, which Hoop states is his favorite studio. The band had used the likes of synthesizers and MIDI before, but Thiessen stated that every instrument on this album, quote, "It's organic. I know a lot of bands do that now, but for us, it was really the first time we made it a real thing," end quote. On April 30th, Thiessen posted that they were tracking drums for the last 3 songs. The new album is almost done. May 5th, 2009, the band announced via the Air One website that The Almost and Relient K were in the same studio and stated that band members were swapping gear to record both bands' albums. With the bands in the studio together, Aaron Gillespie would record for the album, which was confirmed through the release of track listing and guest vocalists.
That gives me a great idea for a TV show, Band Swap. Remember Wife Swap? I remember I went to church once, and the pastor was really upset about the existence of the show Wife Swap. But it's like, you know, it's like a joke, right? You know, it's like, I mean, I guess the show Wife Swap was built off of the idea of like, ooh, we're enticing you with the idea that this is a sexual wife swap, but it's not. It's just a joke where families are going to trade moms for like the cooking and cleaning or whatever, you know, sorry, I'm not trying to be sexist, but that's how the show presented itself, or whatever the mom would actually do or not do in the family. And then everyone will learn to appreciate the mom that they had. Well, let's do Band Swap, where everyone has to swap out lead singers or swap out bassists or drummers. And then everyone gets to learn that they actually like the people they work with, or in the case of like Blink-182 and the Aquabats, they just steal a drummer.
So there's a fandom wiki for this song specifically.
Okay.
Which I don't know if we came across this last time or not, but I do find very interesting because it's definitely not something that comes up like ever.
Yeah, someone had started a fandom wiki for Relient K, but only got so far with it. I remember for some self-titled tracks, there was more work on that fandom wiki where they actually went as far as to reference the biblical references in the song and the verses and the Bible verses that connect to those. but they only did it for the first album.
I'm sorry. There is a commercial playing at the top of this for Fandom Wiki, which I'm already on, and it's playing an Obi-Wan trailer, and it's like, Obi-Wan has the higher ground. Like, what? It just keeps going on and on and on. Forget and Not Slow Down is the single from Relient K's sixth studio album, Forget and Not Slow Down. It was released to radio stations on September 21st, 2009, and released for digital download on September 22nd, 2009. Meaning, Matt Hoops has stated the song means it's about learning from mistakes and not just focusing on all the things you wish you'd done differently. Everyone has those things. What's important is the knowledge that when you make a mistake, your life is not over.
Yep. I agree.
Matt Teason has gone on to state, it's hard to forget and move on emotionally, but sometimes it's better for you. You have to keep the bigger picture in mind. If you're feeling sorry for yourself or reflecting on things that aren't good, you're not being productive. So to move forward is to concentrate on what can I do better. That's the whole idea of the record. So chart positions, Billboard Hot Christian Songs, number 37, christianrock.net, that's the big one. That's the one you really want to chart on, Dan. Right. Weekly Top 30, Top 5. ChristianRock.net, Top 100 of 2009, number 29.
Ooh, but do they really belong there with a song about chicks?
I love appearances. The song was one fans hoped would be a mainstream single, and while that is still possible, it is
all right. Yes,
only
yes.
On Christian rock stations, it has been used to transition or return from commercials at certain sporting events.
Yes, I read that. I remember that because I'm like, wow, this has not been updated. Could you imagine if "Forget and Not Slow Down," the title track, suddenly became a big radio hit in 2022?
Hey, you don't know. They could use it in a commercial or a movie or something.
Or a TikTok.
Or a TikTok, and it could become a big thing. Also, no TikToks popped up this week. So really? I'm like, there's got to be TikToks, but I was not going to go download the app just to look for it. I meant to ask you to do it before the show.
I'll do it.
You can get the CD used at FYE.com.
We bought our copy at Zia Records in Las Vegas.
And then again, I don't know 100% if we've gone over this or not, but we have an article from The Daily Nebraskan.
Okay.
Which I believe is 402-956, oh, yeah. Where our Google Voice is set up. Relient K's Forget and Not Slow Down, an Evolved Album by Tom Helberg, October 5th, 2009.
You keep talking while I get more wine.
Okay. The band now strikes a balance, making more serious music on its LPs and playing with new sounds and goofing around on EPs. Forget and Not Slow Down, the band's sixth studio album, is the band's most musically mature work
to date.
Yeah,
the EPs, that's where we really cut loose, guys.
The band's lead singer and songwriter Matt Teason credits the Counting Crows and Foo Fighters as influences, and though Forget feels like 90s rock, it's easily the most timeless sounding album in the band's catalog. I agree with that. After slide guitars on Five Score and 7 years ago, and several country-tinged tracks on the Bird and the B-sides, it seems plausible that Relient K would venture further down the alternative country path with this album. But instead of another blatant stylistic progression, a folksy flair subtly infuses the music, nearly shutting out punk entirely. The piano rock is more finely integrated than on past albums, and while the piano is more prominent than before, songs no longer feel exclusively like guitar tracks or piano tracks.
That is kind of what I did say. Yeah. The piano and the guitars are all very evenly mixed on this album.
The sounds meld together more seamlessly. Teason was obviously in love while writing Five Score and Forget chronicles the crumbling relationship. While slightly cliched love songs hinder the band's last album, the breakup tunes here are pretty good, never feeling like retreads. The first of the breakup songs, I Don't Need a Soul, favors hope over bitterness, with piano and strings dotting lightly chugging guitars. Rocker Part of It is a more helpless rendition of the breakup theme, boasting a gorgeously glum outro. The band returns to its willingness to play with song structure, adding several separate track intros and outros into this album. I don't know that I could ever be a music writer because you just have to know so many adjectives and just throw them all together. Candlelight is a clear highlight, making bouncy keyboards and guitars to jangle pop perfection. Relient K's signature witty left-turn lyrics make up the chorus. Can't hold a candle to her because all the moths get in the way, for she outshines anyone who ever might dare to bask in the same candlelight. Flair serves as a toy piano peppered outro, but the minute-long waltz doesn't warrant its own track. Mm-hmm, the band's fourth album had songs with similar outros that stayed within the same track. Well, it's a good thought, most of the outros on this album could have taken that route. The exception to the rule is the Savannah Suite, the biggest statement to Relient K's musical growth. With its quickly plucked bass and acoustic guitars, Maracas add a mildly foreign feel. This is different than anything the band has put out so far. An intro and outro bookend the song, and while each track is connected, they all sound like independent works. It all adds up to a dramatic 6-minute miniature epic. Closing tracks, This Is the End and If You Want It, are essentially the same song. The first being the most quote-unquote punk-sounding on the album, and the second is a familiarly glum Teason piano ballad.
Glum Teason, that's a character we don't talk about.
A loose Narnia-esque allegory connects the latter tune with that's the album's hardest rocker, Sahara, which itself darkly likens desertion to dehydrating in the desert.
I'm drinking wine from a pint glass like a hero.
Teason chronicles his months of isolation and prayer writing the album in piano rocker therapy and striving to redefine himself on mid-tempo over it. The album's theme of moving past mistakes and striving for self-improvement culminate on the title track, which sounds like a classic Relient K single, while showcasing the band's new musical sophistication. Depending on where a listener might be in a breakup, Forget Not Slow Down could be either disheartening or therapeutic. The album will dually appeal to new and old listeners as Relient K further refines its sound, mixing perfect pop and timeless rock and roll. Curious Corn Huskers by the Daily Nebraskan is the next trending story.
Let's hear all about it.
So what do you have for us, Danny?
What do I have? Well, I have TikToks.
They're good.
Now, I can't trust that these are all the TikToks, because like we saw last week, you saw like 20 TikToks right on the public page for this particular sound, Daydream as a sound on TikTok. Now, it says I got 3 TikToks I can see. If there's more out there, I don't know why I can't see them.
Guys, let's go make this the new TikTok trend.
So here's the first one. This is Captain Fantastic 94. And it's just Captain Fantastic.
Like a cover.
It's a vocal cover.
Nice.
Can I pause? I can't pause. Oh, I can pause. Cool. So, Captain Fantastic 94 is wearing a wool-lined denim jacket with a Star Wars t-shirt, with a vintage style Star Wars t-shirt underneath. And then Captain Fantastic, when they're like left and right and upright, they're doing hand motions of left and right and upright, and just giving all the bravado. Zoom ins and getting all up in the face of the camera.
Good stuff.
At the end, went doo 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 doo.
I love it.
I gotta preview the TikTok before I start describing it. So this is like a compilation of a family and like a bunch of different videos, I guess, of different things that they've done. This is uploaded by Mercedes_Anastasia, and the text on screen says, "When Vecna comes for me, this is what to put on my headphones." All right, I think this is just a very specific reference to this person's family. And then there's pictures of babies playing. There's a picture of a trip to an aquarium. There's some clips, not pictures. They're getting pizza. They're at some sort of fake presidential podium. There's a baby, like, playing with a toy. There's another older baby who's walking around and falling down. They're feeding a goat. This is just like a family, people together doing finger paints, but they're all like adults. Some people doing karaoke. A mom or someone holding a kid, and a kid, like rubbing a pit bull. Did you see that?
It's adorable.
I think I can. Yes, I can rewind on the app.
I did manage to see it.
And then they're doing like a really, really, really long hopscotch in the middle of like a paint store, of a arts and crafts store. Like they're in a Michael's, like an arts and crafts store. And then there's, yeah, this is a hopscotch board inside the store that's got to be like 24 squares long. Interesting. All right. Well, it's just like a family personal one. I don't think that's really meant for a podcast to discuss.
As opposed to the YouTube stuff we find that we discuss every week?
Well, there are a lot of those that I end up skipping. Like, I did find a lot of, like, this week on YouTube, graduation videos.
This week the trend was graduation videos.
Yeah, I found a lot of graduation videos. Things I definitely didn't find last time, even though they existed. But my YouTube deep dive skills were probably not very good at the time. So Mike, with a Y instead of an I, Mike Clements is the last TikTok we got here. And Mike says on text, oh, they're just talking. I guess I could just let Mike speak for himself. I just have to wait for the video to start over. Because, here we go.
Okay, TikTok, stitch this and tell me your favorite band, their best album, and your favorite album. They can't be the same because we all know if they're your favorite band. They aren't. I'll go first. Relient K, their best album is There for Free. My favorite is Forget It Not Slow Down. Your turn.
So I don't know how many people took up Mike Clements' challenge. What was he saying? Like, you gotta pick a song not from the favorite album?
You gotta, yeah, no, you have to pick your favorite album and what their best album is, but they couldn't be the same thing.
Oh, but they can be the same thing.
Well, you didn't make the TikTok challenge. Go make your own TikTok challenge.
Like, some bands have... Yeah, some bands have, like, quintessential albums to the zeitgeist overall. That... Multiples. Like, MXPX, like, I think you could... You know, Life in General. Sure, everyone would say Life in General is their quintessential album. But then I think a lot of people would say that it's actually their quintessential album is actually Slowly Going the Way of the Buffalo. It's their first full mainstream, major label album. Because Life in General started with Tooth and Nail and then got redistributed by major label after they got signed. I don't know. And then, like, Relient K, like... Mm-hmm, is technically their quintessential best album. But yeah, I guess also Forget Not Slow Down is, like, artistically their best album. Like, that's too debatable. And then, like, what if Forget Not Slow Down is your favorite album, and then you have to say it is... Like, okay, The Clash. The Clash, like, their quintessential album is London Calling. Even though the self-titled and Combat Rock are also, like, super important albums. And then, you know, it's easy to set aside Sandinista... and give them enough rope, because even though there's great songs on those, the albums themselves are a mess. So Combat Rock, London Calling, self-titled, like, it's London Calling. That's their best album. That's, like, their artistic height. Like, they never did anything that really achieved that same level artistically. But that can easily be your favorite album of theirs. Like, what are you supposed to do?
I don't know.
Now, you know who has a number of quintessential albums?
Who?
That could easily be your favorite? Megadeth. They got Rust in Peace. They got...
Countdown to Extinction.
Countdown to Extinction and Euthanasia. And those are all, like, perfect albums.
So, Dan, what do you have for us on YouTube this week?
Let's see. Well, the first thing I got... No, wait. I start with Relient K. It's been so long since we did this. I start with the Relient K footage. So, okay, the live album, we've heard it. We did it last time. I also, like, when I went through, I didn't look at my notes from the seventh episode of this show. except to see if I did find Sam Henson's cover back then. Because when we talked about Daydream, I was like, oh, Sam had a cover of Forget Not Slow Down? I don't remember talking about this. Well, I found it originally. It was there in my notes from 2 years ago. But I wrote my note on the on the seventh episode, and we didn't discuss the cover, was everyone in the club's too loud. Like, everyone was talking over her song. People at the bar weren't paying full attention to her.
Oh, man.
And then she wasn't, like, a friend of the show yet, so I didn't put special note. But we will get to that cover in just a little bit. So I didn't go back and double-check any of my previous notes. But I know we played the live album last time. It's a great performance. It sounds very close to the album, with the exception of they double up that build-up section without the lyrics one time, which I think is the preferred way to hear the song. So let's hear it more recently. This is a very recent performance. This is from Yeah, New York. And this is uploaded by Yara Shalom.
Is it time I be feeling all the ghosts of all the things that haunt me most? So let me be the
John Schneck, just bringing all the energy.
Yep.
Super excited to be there. I didn't notice, and, you know, we have a new, like, splittering thing called Splitter AI, but I'm just starting to get the hang of it, so I wasn't ready to create our own splittered tracks for this episode. But, there's this, I can see it happening here, that maybe I couldn't necessarily hear or pay attention to on the album version, if it exists this way. But here's John Schneck taking, like, a lead guitar melody where he matches the vocal melody. Burn my hand and wash my hands of this. As Thiessen's singing that, Schneck is also playing that exact same melody on the guitar.
Here's John Schneck taking lead guitar. He's the bomb!
They should cover that, and then they should do that. No, wait. We don't really want them to reference that show anymore. That was Charles in Charge.
Oh, right, right, right.
Yeah. I mean, they should do a different theme song, a different 80s
I don't know
theme
why
song.
I got so lost there. It's late.
So let's go from one of the... Speaking of it's late, let's go from one of the... That was one of the most recent performances to this is the first performance of the song ever. Not just is it the oldest one on YouTube, but it is also... It says it's the premiere of the song. From 12 years ago, from June 2009, and I think the album came out in, like, October or November, so several months before the album, this is Relient K playing Forget Not Slow Down for the first time in Raleigh, North Carolina at the Lincoln Theater.
The record, it's called Forget Not Slow Down, and I hope I can
remember. Obviously, this is a 2009... camera phone, or maybe it's a 2009 actual camera, because people might have had a separate camera in their pocket back then if the Lincoln Theater wasn't taking cameras away. So it doesn't sound perfect, but it will sound a little better than the fluttering happening as this person's setting up their camera.
All the things at home.
and this is being performed as microphone Teason. That occasional character we see where he's holding the microphone and everyone else is playing guitar. But I think he played guitar in... No, he was playing piano. He was playing piano in Yeah.
Yeah.
For this song. I definitely... Now, I said this earlier in the show, but I realized I didn't double check. Let's see how they do that sort of bridge. I don't know if it counts as a bridge, but that sort of bridge build-up section that leads into the last sections of the song. Let's see if they... do it twice, once without the vocals.
Yeah, they've just always done it that way live, and it gets the crowd into it. They start clapping.
It's the way better way to do that section of the song, and it now kind of it feels I don't know how to, what emotion is it, but it doesn't feel right on the studio album that that's not how it is. It is so cool and dramatic, and I want to hear that. But luckily that we have the live album version, so we have a very good live performance where they do it that way. But yeah, they've always done it that way. And I'm watching the footage here, and actually, Teason puts on his guitar at this moment in the song. Like, as the rest of the band is building that up, he gets off the piano, he slings on the guitar, he's doing whatever you do to make sure your guitar is actually ready to play, and then he starts helping with that build-up, and then when it cuts off the, and then goes back to the beginning of the build-up, now he's back on the mic with the guitar. So maybe that also helps for that transition, like logistically, physically, getting his guitar ready to go. Let's just hear this kick back into the last part of the song, and then we'll move on. Even that, like, burst of energy back into the end of the song is better when you have the two build-ups. It just feels even better. Whatever. It is what it is. You know what? What good do what-ifs do?
We're going to forget and not slow down and move on.
It's funny that, like, yeah, in 2009, and I'm sure today, the Relient K is a kind of band where it's like, here's a new song, and everyone would get really excited.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I know, I don't think there's a lot of other bands. It's like, yeah, a lot of other bands, you'd say, here's a new song, and people would be like, cool. Some fans would be like, cool.
Right.
But they wouldn't really be excited. But this crowd's excited to hear a new song.
Yeah.
Comparatively, when you see that 2003, or is it 2004? That 2004 Cornerstone, not the one where Catherine jumps into the pit, but the next year, Jessica looks confused. Remember, Catherine Hudson.
I'm always coy about calling her Catherine Hudson. Sorry. I'm just being coy. Like, who's Catherine?
I just like to be coy about it. 2004 Cornerstone, Brian Pittman's last Cornerstone with Relient K, and they play Who I Am, like before the album's even like announced or anything. Maybe the album's announced. No crowd reaction. Crowd couldn't have given less of a crap that they're playing Who I Am, Hates Who I've Been for one of the first times with Brian Pittman, which would become an incredible rarity. Then there's, you know, this is a song that's basically always, like, I have a selection of, like, a 2009 another 2009 performance, a 2014 performance after Ethan and the Johns are gone, a 2016 performance when Dave's back in the band and the rest of the band that helps fill out for, like, Air for Free times. But honestly, like, it's a song that, like, has been performed the same way every time. It's interesting to at least hear between the Yeah performance and that Raleigh 2009 before the album came out, because it's the same band except for, you know, John Warren's not there the second time, but it's most of the same members. But anyway, yeah, it's a song that's been performed with a lot of different versions of Relient K since 2009. But this is a song that got played acoustically a bunch by the Mats. And I know we talked about some of these last time. They're like absolute punk backstage sessions 2011. There's a Spokane, Washington radio performance acoustic. There's a Candlelight Serenade acoustic festival in Utah in 2009, where it's like a full band performance of just acoustic versions of the song. I know they did an acoustic tour. I don't remember if that was 2009.
That's cool. Let's listen to that one.
Okay. I don't think we did this one last time, but for some reason, this song has been performed acoustically by the band on YouTube a number of times. So here's one of them. So if this is a full day festival, this is still when it's light out. I guess it was some sort of like Christian festival of just acoustic performances, I'm getting from the context of the fact that that's what the festival is called. It's Lehi, I don't know how to pronounce this, L-E-H-I, Utah. Lehi, Lehi, Utah. Acoustic Candlelight Acoustic Festival. Thanksgiving. No, it's not. It's called Thanksgiving Point. Oh, the place is called Thanksgiving Point, but the performance was on August 21st, 2010. Okay. So here is the full band playing this song acoustically. He's a time I be fending all the ghosts of all the things that haunt me most. So let me be wild. I'll be wrong with my life. I'll be sure the steps of laps are right. Don't fight the direction of upright. I'd rather forget and not slow down. Than gather things I can't change. Now if I become
I'm just going doo 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 doo.
Hold on, we gotta hear that. We gotta hear that, dude.
Well, I was hoping he'd go for the second.
Yeah. This is not Relient K, by the way. This is Ethan Thiessen and two other people.
Oh my gosh, what?
I don't know if that's...
Oh, wow. Let's see. Yeah,
and like we've talked about this, there's the guy from Paramore who's filled in. There's, you know, a number of times Hoops was out, but there's not even the Johns there. So I don't know. I don't know what the situation was. But this particular video, they're a little too far away to tell. Let's hear that bridge. Let's hear that build up. My favorite part of the song. Let's hear how it sounds acoustic. Okay, well, acoustic, they're not going to do the repeated build-up. They're like, nah, too emotional, too raw. We got to get this song over with faster. let's see. Yeah, I know, I'm almost positive we talked about the Variance magazine and the Absolute Punk live acoustic versions.
Yeah.
And the Spokane, Washington one. We might not have done this one because I don't remember. No, we did talk about this one. But I don't remember talking about the way it's introduced.
Yo, this is Matt. Yo, this is the other Matt, and we're in a band called Relient K, and this song is called Forget and Not Slow Down right here on punkvideosrock.com.
I don't know why that's so beautiful.
I love that.
Right here the on punkvideosrock.com.
Like, the intro was like, you're watching metal up your metal on cable access.
It looks like a cable access show. I'm sure punkvideosrock.com is just a place where people go to ask, when's this band coming to Brazil? So let's hear a little. Let's hear how the bridge goes with just the with just one guitar by Hoops, and just Teason sitting there singing on the mic. Let's see hear how they do the bridge here.
Resurrect the saint from within the wretch. Pour over me and wash my hands. Over me and wash my hands. 'Cause I could spend my life just trying to sift through it. I could have done better, but what could you all just do?
Punkrocksvideo.com had a lot of cameras. They got a lot of coverage. I think they got three cameras going here. They're editing back and forth.
Fancy.
Good for them. I do remember talking about this 2 years ago because it looks like they're in the middle of a, like, it looks like they're in the middle of a school cafeteria.
Based on their outfits, I believe this was done during Van's Warped Tour.
Right. I think they did a couple of these on Van's Warped Tour for a couple of different sites.
Yeah.
Because there's another one that I think is a little bit more popular where they're sitting on a couch. I know that the Max Res default, you know, the screen cap from YouTube for the one where they're sitting on the couch together, that pops up in image searches all the time for Relient K for whatever reason. So maybe it was like posted to a lot of blogs or something. That one's more popular, but this is the one where they're up against a yellow brick wall, not the yellow brick road, but a yellow brick wall, and it looks like they're in a school cafeteria where all the tables have been removed.
Something I should tell you. I'd rather forget and not slow down.
That's interesting. They just kind of cut the... See, this is how you... Like, the band themselves know if you're going to do an acoustic version really stripped down, there's some sections of the song you have to edit, which is what we come up against with a lot of people's acoustic covers all the time. They just want to do the song exactly the same as they know it on the album. It's like you got to kind of, sometimes based off the emotion you're able to project or the emotion that you might not be expecting that is projected from your performance, your natural voice, and the circumstance of the room you're in, you kind of have to edit down the song, maybe extend some parts. The one I'll never forget is that wedding video where they just flat out tried to do the album, that one song exactly like... well, never mind. I can move on. Something happened with... I screen record when I'm playing clips and that failed. Great, now I have to do this later. So let's move on to covers. Oh, no. First, we're going to skip ahead to fan stuff because I found this... And it is outstanding, and it ties back to one of those, one of the live acoustic performances. So this is Wrecked Radio on YouTube, and it's basically like,
Oh, that's cute.
Hey, it's just Paul of Wrecked Radio.
This is from 10 years ago, and it's basically like an emo news show on YouTube. She looks. She almost looks like you, except she's got the much more emo hair from the mid-2000s.
I wish I could grow my hair that long.
She's on a very badly keyed green screen. She's trying to do that newscaster thing on YouTube thing.
You're shaking that, but there's an Anthony Kiedis quote that I'm looking at right now.
So she's trying to do... Let's get the Bluetooth closer to the microphone.
There's going to be a video directed, and all we know is that it'll be directed by rapper.
So first, she's talking.
Craig Sean, who did the song.
I guess she's going to talk about rock in general, but there is sort of a focus on sort of Warped Tour, emo adjacent music of the 2000s, especially based off her look, her hair. She's got that full emo hair. It's one color, but it's very long and lush emo style hair. And she's in a very, very badly keyed green screen. And the decisions just keep going in terms of Wrecked Radio giving you the emo news that you can use, even though she leads with Red Hot Chili Peppers news.
They put all their production money into the little, like, cool stop motion thing at the beginning.
Are you guys excited? Right. I am. Do you guys know who Craig Sean is? And being his Paramore fans get excited because the Transformer single was released as a music video.
They're talking about the Paramore song on the Transformer soundtrack and the news that the video is coming out. Are you excited, Jessica?
I'm so excited.
In a kind of dilapidated room. One of my favorite parts was kind of the shots where they were all lying in water. I really loved that for some reason. It was simple, but it was very artistic.
This is where I'm going to go to get all my punk emo news from now on.
Excuse me, Wrecked Radio. I don't need your opinions on the news. I just want objective news about the Paramore music video from the Transformers soundtrack. I don't need you telling me that them laying in water looked cool. I just need objective news. I don't need
also,
your commentary.
You can see the acoustic version of Relient K's Forget and Not Slow Down. This was featured on Behind the Scenes of Warped Tour. And it's during some of the most exciting news that I've heard this week. Following Reverse's new album, The Drug and Me Is You, can be full streamed on their website. I haven't heard it yet because when I got on it, it was a little slow and wasn't coming up. Hopefully you guys will have better luck than I do.
Jessica's got her hand. Jessica full face pump.
No. It's because she sounds like a softcore actress that's, doing a horror movie.
Nothing to offend the lady.
No.
Who did this. I know she kept doing these videos for many years. I think the last one was 3 years ago.
That's awesome.
And they got better and better quality. But I just love that there's a very specific emo news you can use situation with a green screen. Such a very specific YouTube vibe that a lot of people tried to do at the time. And she's excited about Falling in Reverse's new song, but she went to the website and it was slow, so she didn't get to hear it. Maybe on the next episode she's going to let you know.
So exciting. Tell me what you think of it if you guys have any thoughts, because I will most...
And then I just want to mention, but this is before you had to say there's a paid promotion here, because someone sent her their demo, and so she premiered the demo on her show. She's like, I really loved this demo that I heard. And then the image is just this guy's head and neck, like he's taking a selfie video against a slushy ad, like some sort of juice ad. I don't understand. Aesthetically, this is beautiful. I'm definitely posting it to the social media. He's just going to talk about, thanks for sharing my single.
I absolutely loved the very, they're kind of emotive folk. It reminds me
emotive
of
folk.
Bright Eyes, Connor Oberst.
She just really sounds like Leanna Quigley. Or however you pronounce her first name, which, apologies.
It's Leanna Quigley.
Leanna Quigley fans.
I just put out an EP under the name Incaps. My sister said.
It's the most cursed thing. It's like he's an acoustic emo guy. Unsigned acoustic emo guy from 10 years ago, and he got his EP premiered on Wrecked Radio's YouTube channel, and he took the worst selfie video of all time up against a Frutisa Freeze ad on the wall. Why?
Classic lemonade margaritas. It's amazing.
I just did a whole bunch of, whatever. It's not exactly the same thing, but I just did a whole bunch. I had to do a whole bunch of video interviews when I was looking for my new job, right? And I talked to job recruiters and they're like, make sure you have a neutral background. Don't have a lot of stuff in the background. Don't have anything that's distracting. I was like, I should have asked, do you think I should get a Frutisa Freeze ad and put it in the background? Right up all around my face.
And the song you're going to hear from it is track 5, and it's called Tomorrow in Your Eyes.
Well, anyway. So that was. She did. So Wrecked Radio did talk about the same acoustic performance from punkrocksvideo.com or whatever. So let's go into Sam Henson's cover now that we did not play last time. Here it is, live at Old Ironside, Sacramento, where the audience is just not being respectful. And I'd like to hear how this is sort of done, especially the bridge, which
Google
I love.
Google Fi, a phone plan by Google.
Yes, I don't have YouTube Premium. Here we go.
The things that haunt, leave me alone. What's wrong with my life? I'm
It's such a shame. You can hear all these people in the background talking and chatting it up.
Let me hear the cover, babe.
Okay.
Left and right, don't fight. Direction over bright. Rather forget and not slow down. Rather regret for the things I can't change now. Become what I can't accept. Resurrect the same from within the wreck.
Dude, so good.
Do. Yeah, it's really good. Let's go.
Sam's got a great voice.
Yeah, let's go 2 minutes in.
Except resurrect the same from within the wreck.
I managed to pick pretty much the same part of the song as 2 minutes before.
Over me and wash my hands. Over me and wash my hands. Cause I spent my life just trying to see who I could do no better, but we could do what it's to.
It's great. It's really good. Sorry. Jessica was kind of like, oh, this is like a lullaby. I'm going to sleep. So here is... this is kind of like a fun... It's kind of like... So this is the Meeting Place, which I think is a Christian fellowship of some sort.
It certainly sounds like it.
They're called the Meeting Place. And they kind of end up sounding a little like post-indie... But, like, by mistake, and then clearly it's just, like, kind of a lack of, like, their instruments. But, you know, you could almost kind of polish this up in some ways and put it on some sort of, like, post-indie rock label. So here is the Meeting Place's cover of Forget Not Slow Down, their full band worship set.
So they leave me alone, move on with my life.
I mean, this just sounds like jangly, like it's not exactly there, but it could, you fix a couple corners of this and this could almost be jangly pop punk. This could be Twinkle, this is Jangle Daddy or Twinkle Daddy emo or something.
Sure.
The steps are left and right, don't fight the direction of the bright. I'd rather forget, not slow down. Gather regret for the things I can't change. Have I become what I can't accept? Resurrect the same from within the wretch. Pour over me and wash my hands of it.
Do.
It's a guitar tone.
Yeah.
That's why it has that, yeah.
This is a guitar tone that you hear in a lot of, like, credible, artsy post-pop punk. That's not, like, nothing that's big nowadays, but it comes up. Like, nothing that's, like, honestly, this, it sounds like a lot of stuff, but it's just, like, it's just certain, like I said, edges of it that need to be changed and...
Great,
you know,
cover, though.
Yeah, great cover. I just love the idea that you would take, like, a worship band that kind of accidentally sounds kind of jangly and be like, hey, guys, we're going to polish you up and we're going to make you a post-pop punk band. There's a bunch of covers that I remember from last time that I really liked. Like, The Wild Cards is another church cover that was actually, like, a really just good church cover where a bunch of people come running up to the front and start dancing, like full-on dancing in the front, like joyously, like not in a worship way, but just like legs and arms and just kicking up and dancing in this like church get-together. And when I posted that 2 years ago, an early interaction from John Schneck, he replied to that and he said, this is beautiful. But yeah, you can go check out The Wild Cards because I do remember we played it last time. And I'll probably share it again this time. But one I will play from last time again is this amazing electronic cover by Trey, T-R-E-Y, that I think is, like, officially published and licensed. I think it's on streaming and everything, but this is a SoundCloud. This is a SoundCloud upload by Trey.
One.
Yeah, it's so great. Good. It's so good. I could play all 3.5 minutes.
Right.
So something that we haven't had a chance.
Just vibing.
Yeah. Something we haven't actually had a chance to play on the show. Although I do remember talking about it the week it came out and helping to promote it when it was released, was an official tribute album. Not official tribute album, but a properly licensed tribute album on Bandcamp called K, The Only Reliable Letter, a tribute to Relient K. I think one other time we've played a song, just looking, because we did a bunch of these songs before this tribute came out. Maybe it was Look On Up that we played, I can't remember, but this has 9 tribute songs to Relient K. And I know with Bandcamp, you have to like officially license your cover songs. You can't just do a cover like YouTube and SoundCloud and upload it. Like you can't, and then like hope for the best, hope you don't get a copyright strike. Like Bandcamp doesn't want you to upload stuff unless you have officially licensed it from the license holder. I've heard about this from Greg Simpson of They Might Be a Podcast. He licenses everything that he releases as a cover. So this is Acid Flashback at Nightmare Beach. And this is their cover of Forget and Not Slow Down. It's the opening track to the K is the Only Reliable Letter, a tribute to Relient K album. This is what I was talking about with the meeting place. Like, there's this post-pop thing, and this is the kind of stuff that's deliberately done here by Nightmare Beach.
I was going to say, with a name like Acid Metal Bloodfest, I was not expecting this style of music.
This is like that. I think this is like some of that new Gen Z music that I don't really get yet. Like that hyper-pop, that's a thing.
I just want to say that I think it's hilarious that we're like, oh, yeah, we love the Last Woman one, and we're being with that one, and this one we're like, nah.
Yeah, but this is making a specific, this is something that we don't necessarily see a lot, where this might be confrontational to listen to, but this is deliberate. This is, they know what they're doing, unlike maybe some other like covers that we find on YouTube where it might not sound right and that's actually like the limits of their talent. Like, this is a band, this is like a post-pop band deliberately doing it this way. So I'm going to skip 1:42 in.
Yeah.
Again, this is definitely an artistic, deliberate creation. Jessica does not like it. This kind of world of like Gen Z, post-pop, hyper-pop, all that stuff.
Okay, old man.
Well, that's the thing, is I was going to say, like, the only band that people of our generation, that millennials accept from this world is 100 Gex. They're like the one group from this, like, sound that, like, millennials know the name of is 100 Gex. And I don't know the subtleties of these new genres of, like, deliberately confrontational pop music. Oh, okay, here's a full band version that's quite a bit more punk. It's actually, like, a little bit more punk. Like, and this is not going to confront you like that last cover did. This is just a full-on, like, emo-style pop-punk band from 7 years ago, and I don't think I found this cover last time. This is Our Life Now, covering Forget and Not Slow Down.
Murder on Moonlight Beach did do a great job, though, for what they were going for.
We should write down all these names and just create bands to compete with them. I like that bass lead on this version.
They got the lights and the smoke going?
Yeah.
Whoa. Nice punk cover.
Oh, this is not necessarily America.
Okay.
I'm just looking at the YouTube description, and it's in Spanish.
Nice. Well, they are doing a rocking job.
Yes, they are. So, yeah. I was trying to find out what club they were at because they had all the lights and stuff. And I was like, it could just be the club they performed at, had all these extra lights and everything. But now I can't really tell because it's in Spanish. Oh, there is an English translation. I accidentally closed it right as I saw that. And now we're moving on. So, there was a very transformative acoustic cover. Let me find that. Oh, I posted this before I get to that. I posted this one early. I posted this one ahead of us doing this episode. This is Melissa Aquino. This is from 2 years ago, so definitely we did not play this one because it was right around the time we started the podcast. And this is their cover. This is Evening of Guitar, December 2019.
Okay.
Yeah, this is weeks after we originally did this episode. And it doesn't say what city, but this is a six-piece band of young people. Some of them look like teenagers. Some of them look like they're in their early 20s. Can't quite tell. And maybe all of the musicians are younger and the singer's a little older, but here is their performance for what looks like a crowd of parents. I can't really tell. And this is their cover of Forget Not Slow Down with a female singer.
And I'm Cassie, and we're going to be playing Forget Not Slow Down by Relient K.
Good stuff. Love her voice.
Yeah, it's great. It could be Melissa. That could be Melissa herself, or that could be a friend or a parent who uploaded the video.
Good stuff.
But that's Melissa's YouTube channel. And then, there's a bunch of covers, but I want to play this one other one that's like full on, totally different from... Here it is. This is Alex. This is Alex, and they...
Think you have what it takes to play with Metallica?
Oh my goodness.
The best way to play like us is to play with us.
It's something
that's
app.
Very rude. This is a family podcast, sir.
That was some sort of... This is some sort of app where you can learn to play like Metallica by, like, watching play-along videos of them playing themselves. Whatever. Anyway, this is Forget Not Slow Down cover by Alex. Yep, this is the correct one. And so Alex here, like, totally changes up the cadence of the song, and it's fascinating. And it's only got 400... views after 8 years, but it's got 14 comments, which you barely ever see comments on these covers. So this definitely got some interest out of those 400 views. So here's that cover.
How many times can I push it aside? It's time I be a friend of the curse of all the things that hold me most. So they leave me alone.
And there's a labradoodle that keeps coming.
Be certain the steps of left and right don't fight the direction of a pride. I'd rather forget and not slow down than gather regret for the things I can't change now. If I become what I can't accept, resurrect the same from within the
There's a big labradoodle right in Alex's face that's like, I don't understand what you're doing. Pay attention to me.
I love this. Love their voice. So, good.
It's just something, it's got like a, it's more of a swinging cadence to it. And then I think it really changes up after this part.
It feels summery.
It does feel summery. It's almost like a ukulele cover, but it is a guitar.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like the cadence of a ukulele cover on a guitar. And then I think things change up even more after this point.
It's time to decide which is out of my mind. Cause it wouldn't be me unless I put some thoughts to rest and leave some faults behind. I'll watch the glint in my eye.
See, so whatever the transformation is, like, it's almost like the lyrics are catching up, like the vocal rhythm is catching up to how Alex is totally changing the rhythm and cadence of the song, and then things aren't quite matching, but Alex is just pushing forward, and I enjoy that.
It's very enjoyable.
Yeah. Let's see if Alex does the the elongated bridge.
You just want to see the dog again.
Yeah. It is way more upbeat. It's, yeah, interesting. It's really cool. So, I found one of those things. Maybe we'll do a Patreon about it.
Oh.
It's one of those things. Do you remember when I found someone had done, I think it was for the band. I could be wrong, but it was definitely an older song where someone had, like, their idea for a, like, a Disney Channel or
yes.
Nickelodeon
yes,
TV
I do.
Show.
Yes, I do.
And they cast it with, like, Zac Efron uh-huh. and Miley Cyrus and Taylor Swift. And
uh-huh.
they would write the script in the editing software and put the dialogue up on the screen.
Yep, yep.
I think I found something that, if not by that same person, then similar.
Amazing.
Where it's a picture of Taylor Swift and a picture of a younger, like, what's the thing called? Hey There Montana? Hayden Montana?
Hannah Montana?
A post-Hannah Montana, but pre-Wrecking Ball, Miley Cyrus. And it just keeps going back and forth between these two images as dialogues up on the screen. And they're talking about something. So it's someone's, like, script. Some kid's, like, friend fiction.
Outstanding. We will go cover that over on Patreon.
But what's funny about it, I'll just give the credit so people can go watch it if they want to, although we're not going to talk about it right now, is it's uploaded by Maggie Moo 9694. And it says, season 3, episode 43, Forget and Not Slow Down. So this is like their 43rd little episode cast by Taylor Swift and Miley Cyrus. But then they write Forget and Not Slow Down. And then in the description, it says, okay, you can hate me if you want because I'm so dumb. I put the wrong Relient K song in. Oh my God. Are you reeling me? I'm so sorry I screwed up yet again. Please forgive me. Okay? I need you guys to remember this episode. It is very important for the future. Remember episode 44. Okay. Cool. Toodles. And then it still says song, Forget and Not Slow Down, but it's not.
That's what you're supposed to be hearing.
That's what you're supposed to be hearing. Okay. But I was like, someone can tell Maggie from 2009 that you can go in and change the title of the episode and the description so that it's
I think given up slowly. I think that they meant to put Forget and Not Slow Down as the song.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
But if as long as they accidentally didn't, they could have just gone in and changed the whole vibe.
You don't know.
People need to know it was supposed to be Forget and Not Slow Down.
Yeah.
All right. Well, here's a horse video. This is Horse Crazy 3000, because this is something we come across all the time. There's a subset of Relient K fans that love their horses, and they set tributes of their horses to Relient K music on YouTube. It happens all the time.
Good stuff.
They're riding side saddle. They're riding non-saddle. They're jumping over stuff. Driving? That's what you do, right? You drive a horse. Well. Yeah, I'll end on that. There's a bunch of AMVs. Nothing, no fandoms that you are, like, particularly interested in that I can bring to you. Like, lots of graduation and summer camp tribute videos. But I'll end on this. So, Crease, if I'm saying that right, Crease comes up, C-R-E-E-S, big person in the Relient K fan community on social media. We talk to them once in a while, and I know they're big on the Discord, the Relient K Discord, and we've come across, Crease had also originally uploaded the AutoZone song.
Oh, nice. Yeah,
so
yeah.
If it wasn't for that upload, we might not have done that episode, and then, you know, spoken to Warren about getting the better quality version. Well, Crease did like a shitpost video that is about some discussion, which I don't understand it. Yeah, this might have been from the Discord. This might have been, so to give you context, I think this was a discussion on the Relient K Discord where Water Buffalo, I'm on the Relient K Discord, but I haven't used it in months because I really just don't like the format of Discord. I don't like that it's a constantly flowing conversation. I don't like that every fucking time I go into a Discord room and say hi, everybody disappears. I don't like that every time I go in and make a point or there's a conversation going on and I'm like, oh yeah, I agree, or I know something about that. Here's some other fact, and nobody replies to me. That's happened 9 times out of 10 to me on Discord. But then, like, if
guys,
things...
Guys, go be nice to Danny on Discord.
But then if things are interesting, I'm like, I got a life. Like, I can't constantly be on this Discord when it is going, and no one's there when I am there. So I hate Discord. I just flat out hate the format of Discord. Not just... not the Relient K one specifically. Everyone on the Relient K Discord is super nice. But I guess Water Buffalo, and this is from 1 year ago, said how, I remember the first few months of me listening to Forget and Not Slow Down. I downloaded the album from this shady, jailbroken app. And instead of the actual Relient K original Baby, it gave me the Justin Bieber Baby cover. So Crease, if I'm pronouncing that right, made this kind of video to give you the idea of what it would have been like for Water Buffalo. And it said, so it went from Oasis, Savannah, and then into the Justin Bieber cover. Until then.
Oh, 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 oh. That's fantastic.
And this obviously doesn't relate to the song Forget Not Slow Down, but this is something that didn't exist the last time I searched the phrase Forget Not Slow Down specifically 2 years ago. So that's, I was like, great. I gotta mention this. And then Water Buffalo says, I didn't find out it was a mistake until like 3 months later. Oh, no. So they always thought that it was... It was Oasis, Savannah, and Justin Bieber's Baby.
Like, man, this album is amazing, except I don't know why they put this cover of Justin Bieber's Baby in the middle of it.
One thing I would say to Chris, this is a great video, and I am nitpicking.
Gosh darn it, Danny.
I am nitpicking. I'm sorry, Chris, but I would have taken the Baby cover and that fade out of Savannah, and I would have overlapped them just a little to make it, which would not have been Water Buffalo's experience. It would have obviously just cut off and directly led.
Yeah.
It would have. So, you know what? Kreese is specifically giving us exactly as it would have sounded to Water Buffalo when they downloaded from the Shady MP3 site. But I would like to make the fake, and I don't want Kreese to think I'm ripping them off, which I would in a way, but I want to make like the perfectly faded, like, even if you can adjust the key of the, like, the guitar tone that leads out of the first song into the second song, like, if you could match them perfectly, blend them perfectly, like, it was always intended. So, Jessica.
Yes.
What do you think of the song Baby by Justin Bieber? Do you like it more, the same, or less?
I guess I like Baby the same.
Okay, well,
and
what
I
do
like
you...
Forget Not Slow Down even more
I
every
do.
Time.
That's right, and we didn't have our outro voting. Oh, yeah. Right, because I'm pretty sure Chris did the thing where it was like the. What if. There was a thing where we did.
Danny, you just had a conversation in your head.
What's the Baby You Look So Sexy song? What's that called? Disaster. When we did Disaster, we found a different shitpost video that Chris did about the Baby You Look So Sexy thing. Anyway. Yeah. We didn't have our voting system at the end when we originally did this episode. So I think originally, if we had voted 2 years ago, I would have said, I like this song even more. But it's like my love for you, Jessica. At the time... 2 years ago, I would think, oh, there's no way I could love this song more. I already love it more than I've ever loved anything in my life. But no, I love it even more. My capacity for love itself grows more every day that I listen to Forget and Not Slow Down and that I live life with you. So that is Forget and Not Slow Down. And we will talk to you guys later. Have a great week. I don't know if we'll be off next week because I might have to go to my grandmother's memorial, but we'll figure that out. I'm just throwing that out there. We had a fun time. I love you guys, and we will hope to see you next week or very soon.
Thanks for listening. Stay safe.
Until then.